So, as you know, I'm leaving Google. So, to do what? To do this. This is Ali, for those of you who have not met him. So handsome. So handsome. Ali, as I told you, was my son and my son, as I always say. He lit my life. Ali was born when I was 25, end of 24. So, and I failed to grow up, if you want. So I remained a child throughout his life. We played a ton of video games together. We played a ton of music together. We looked, you know, we read books together, and he was a tremendously funny character, and so we watched a ton of comedies together. This young man completely changed the way I looked at my life. He had a tattoo on his back that read, "The gravity of the battle means nothing to those at peace." And you know, the word "the battle" in video games is everyday life. So truly, when you really think about what Ali was trying to say here, he was basically saying, everything that happens every day doesn't really matter if you're at peace. So I want to show you his model of how, you know, to find that peace regardless of what life gives you. You know this story. Ali, I was diagnosed with an appendectomy. And went for the simplest operation known to mankind and to humankind, and five things went wrong in a row, and within 4 hours we lost Ali. Some of you may not know, but Ali, and I don't know if you're willing to believe this, but so it was all of a sudden, it was human error, but somehow I think he knew. So for 6 weeks before his death, Ali spoke to every single one of his friends about what happens to us before we die, when we die. So he constantly asked that question, and he never really, you know, he spoke very little. So people would say their answer, and he would ask questions, and then just say, "Okay, that's interesting." Until the very last time, he asked his friend Dima. Her name was Dima, and then he said, "Okay, I think I've heard enough. I think we will only know for sure when we get there, but I'm optimistic," which was the most fabulous message a father can get, that, you know, Ali truly made his peace with him, with himself going, even before he left. And you know, he constantly just gave us very strong signals that he almost knew that he was going. One of them was that he sat us down 4 days before he left. We were having lunch, and Ali didn't speak much in general, but that day he spoke for 40 minutes straight. 40 minutes, myself, his mother, his sister, around the table, he would turn to each of us, look us in the eye, and talk about how much he loved us, what he valued about us, how he appreciates what we did for him, and how it made him the person that he is. It was basically a grandfather dictating his will. And of each one of us, he asked us to do one thing differently to change our lives. And of me, as you can imagine, he said, "Papa, I know that you're trying so hard to make the world a better place. I want you to never stop working, but I want you to do that depending on your heart, not on your brain." And so, in his exact words, he said, "I want you to depend on your heart a little more often." So when he left and we did so well as a family to be at peace in that battle, my friends started to say, "You know what you just explained to us about happiness and how you're going through this so peacefully? You need to write this down." And it immediately triggered my idea of writing Soul for Happy and of that mission that was called 10 Million Happy. And 10 Million Happy literally took around 8 weeks to break. So within 8 weeks, we had more than 100 million views, which I don't count as 100 million happy, just so that you know. We'll talk about that at the end. But the mission was in movement. It was in motion, and it was clear that the people that actually prioritized their happiness and took the action were in excess of 10 million, and so we took it up to 1 billion happy. So you know about that from yesterday's presentation. But I need you to make me a promise, because now that you're here and I'm going to spend an hour of my life to try and make you happier, so you need to do something for me in return. That's the businessman in me. So before we start, I'm going to say, if at the end of the hour you have learned a couple of things that make you happier, I need you to promise to move the mission forward. So I need you to promise that you're going to tell two people who will tell two people who will tell two people. I promise? Good, very good. If I tell you more than two things, as I always say, then be generous and tell 20 people. Okay? Four people? Okay. Tell 15. 15 is a good number, right? Good. So let's talk about happiness. I know all of you, by the way, evident by the fact that you're here, are super interested in the topic of happiness. By that, you know, I'm sure that you also have a ton of research, have done a ton of research on the topic. Some of what I'm going to tell you is not new, but a lot of it is said in a very different way, and some of it is new, right? Let's start with the very basic question. I was very happy as a young man. Until age 23, I was the happiest man you will ever meet, right? And life wasn't easy at all. As a matter of fact, we literally did not have enough to eat. I was educated in Egypt, you know, schools and universities, which sort of means I wasn't really educated. I was, you know, trying to go on through life and earn a living and so on, and I didn't care. I was the happiest man you can ever meet. By age 29, I became really unhappy, right? And I started to struggle with the question, why is happiness so hard to find? I had all of the money, the resources, the wealth that I could pour onto that topic of happiness and become happy. And it hit me that I must be looking in all the wrong places, right? If all of the money that I am trying to put behind buying gadgets and going on vacations and so on is not working, it's maybe because happiness is not found in those things. And so as an engineer, if I gave you a machine that broke down, the first thing you would ask me is, when did it break down, right? What was good working condition? How did it operate before it broke down? And so I started to do that. I started to look at myself as a machine and ask myself, when did this break down? 23, I was okay. 21, I was okay. 16, I was happy. 14, I was happy. 11, I was happy. At zero, I was happy. And that was a very eye-opening statement for me, because at zero, I had nothing at all. Do you understand that? The day you are born, you're happy. And if you don't believe me, all you need to do is to look at those little guys. Right? And I'm telling you, even you, when you were their age, of course you were not always cheerful. Sometimes you cried like a baby, obviously, right? But most of the time, if you were given food, shelter, safety, warmth, your very basic needs of survival, what was your state? You were happy. You were on your back, looking at the ceiling, playing with your toes, and feeling happy. Right? Simply. You didn't need anything. You didn't need an Xbox to be happy. You didn't need anyone to tell you, wow, have you been working out to be happy? Right? Right? It was super easy. Happiness was not triggered by anything outside you. It was just there inside you. Right? A diaper would get wet. You cry for a bit. They change the wiper, the diaper, you're back. No problem at all. It's like, whoops, no reason for unhappiness. I'm happy. Right? And so in technology, we call that the default setting. And the default setting is how you're supposed to operate. So you buy a new mobile phone, you take it out of the box, and it works perfectly well, right? The default setting of that machine is to preserve energy in a certain way, to switch the screen off every 30 seconds, to be operating in English or Spanish or whatever your language is, and so on, right? You take that machine, and 2 days later, it starts to go berserk. It doesn't work anymore, right? The battery starts to wear down, and you have to charge twice a day, and the menus start to be clunky, and nothing really works anymore as the day that it was out of the box, right? And you wonder, why? Is there something wrong? Did I buy the wrong phone? No. You bought the right phone, but you started to install weird apps on it, right? You know that app that is in charge of reporting to you what everyone around the world eats, right? And it gives you the obligation that you actually have to like and say, I like this, even though you don't really like it, right? Nothing wrong with the app, by the way. Huh? The app is performing exactly what it's supposed to do. Nothing wrong with the phone, but you put them together and the phone doesn't work as well anymore. Now, I would dare say that this is what happens to us as humans. We are born happy, and then we start to install weird apps, right? Every one of those weird apps truly messes with our operating system. Those weird apps come in the form of societal obligations, parental obligations, you know, values that you start to learn that are not necessarily true. Most of those values, remember, are there to tell you that that you are supposed to be successful. right? You're supposed to fit in life, but they're not there to make you happy. So you think of one of those apps that says the shape of your body matters, right? And you take that app to heart and you spend the rest of your life looking at that one tiny little dot on your forehead and say, I'm not good enough, I'm not pretty enough, right? Or you look at yourself and say, you know, I'm not successful enough, my neighbor is making more money than me, I need to improve on this or that or the other. And all of those lead to that perpetual state of dissatisfaction with how you're going through life. Now, that default setting was beautifully summarized in a song by Supertramp. Any Supertramp fans? Yes, those are the interesting guys in the room. Thank you, right? For those people who are younger, I would probably say this is your homework for today, so you need to download, seriously, download the logical song, because truly in 60 seconds, 40 seconds sharp, they summarize the story of your life. This is how the logical song goes. Do we have audio? Yeah? Yep, right? And the interesting thing is that they didn't send you away to be happy. Remember that? They sent you away to be intellectual, cynical, critical, and so on and so forth. And you have to really think very deeply about that. Because we humans are very capable. We set our minds to something, and we get it done. Right? And so, interestingly, intellectual and cynical are at the core of unhappiness. And I'll tell you why in a couple of seconds. Did I say this was your homework? I forgot to say you should listen to it 50 times this week, right? I'm not making play it on repeat until it sinks in there, right? So for those who are visual thinkers, this is the way I see it. The happy me is still in there. The little happy child is in there. Every weekend you've ever spent when your boss was not annoying, your partner didn't say something rude, you know, the sun was shining, you forgot about that promotion or whatever it was that was making you unhappy, and you just return back to that happy child. You know, those happy children in us are covered with all of those societal expectations, with parental expectations, with all of those weird apps, right? And if you remove them one by one, interestingly, what's left behind is happy. So remember the diaper. In a very interesting way, for that child, when there was a reason for unhappy, the child became unhappy. When the unhappiness was removed, we return back to happiness, which translates into one of the simplest statements you're going to ever see. Happiness is the absence of unhappiness. Right? Now, this really is so simple that it shocked me when I discovered that. I remember vividly 2004, I was at my mother's house, and I realized that I've been spending 5 years of research, cosmopolitan style, trying to look for the 10 things that I can do to be happy. There are no 10 things you can do to be happy. There are no 2 things you can do to be happy. There is 1 thing you can do to be happy, which is to stop being unhappy. Do you understand that? That's really, truly it. You stop being unhappy, and what's left behind is happy. Now, it sounds simple, but my research flipped upside down because I was no longer looking for reasons for happiness. I was looking for what was wrong with the machine, the reasons for unhappiness. And if I could remove those reasons for unhappiness, what's left behind is happy. Okay? So, you need to reset the machine. We need to remove the apps one by one so that we find happiness again. What is happiness? Now, here is this engineer, grumpy as we all are, and looking at this topic saying, let's remove the reasons for unhappiness and what will be left behind is happy. We're almost there, Mo. Let's go and do it. And then I was like, But what if happiness is right here and you can't see it because you don't know what you're looking for? And I started to ask people, what is happiness? And yesterday we spoke about that. There's actually very few universal definitions of happiness. And to an engineer, that doesn't work. I cannot work until you tell me what the problem I'm trying to solve is. So I started to look for a definition for happiness. I couldn't find any, and so I started to do it like scientists would do it. I took as many data points as I could find in my life where I felt happy, and I literally started to plot them on a chart. As a matter of fact, as many charts as I could think of, trying to find a trend line. If I could find a trend line on which all of my happiness points were happening, that trend line in mathematical sense is the line I can regenerate whenever I want to be happy. If A equals something and B equals something is a point on that line, I can produce another moment of happiness by finding another A and another B. Weird, I know it sounds weird, but that's the way we think. I was reverse engineering the machine. I was trying to take the readings of how the machine is performing to try and understand what triggers happiness, what triggers unhappiness. And you know what? I started with a list that was called the happy list. It basically is the answer to the sentence, I feel happy when. And you can think about that for a few seconds, or maybe make it your homework. But I feel happy when I have a good cup of coffee. I feel happy when I listen to music. I feel happy when Aya, my daughter, smiles, and so on. Right? While doing that happy list exercise, a few insights popped up. One of them was, there isn't anything there that says, I feel happy when I win the Nobel Prize. Have you ever seen that? Did you ever see anyone where you tell him, what makes you happy, and he says, I feel happy when I buy a Ferrari? Right? No one does that. As a matter of fact, every moment in our life where we felt happy was a very simple moment. I feel happy when I have a good cup of coffee. Honestly, right? I feel happy when I'm with people I love. I feel happy when I learn something new. When I realized that, something amazing came over me, which is an overwhelming sense of gratitude. I can reproduce those on a daily basis in my life. As a matter of fact, there were 92 points on my happy list when I did that exercise, of which there were 80 I could do every day. Right? And suddenly I started to tell myself, wow, I should do them every day, right? It's like so stupid that we don't even know what makes us happy, even though we say we're looking for happiness. So that happy list exercise, and by the way, just working on the exercise makes you happy. Because you keep remembering, I feel happy when I see my daughter smiles. I started to look at pictures of my daughter every time I saw that statement, see her smile and make myself happy. Just the work on the happy list made me happy. But remember, this wasn't my objective. My objective was to find a trend line. I was trying to understand how the machine works. And you know what the trend line is? It's so simple, it would shock you, right? The only common theme across all of the moments in your life you felt happy or all of the moments in your life you felt unhappy was this. I feel happy when life seems to be going my way, which really is very unusual. It's, you know, want to see it graphically, this is how it looks like. If the events of my life don't meet my expectations of how life should be, I feel unhappy. When life seems to be giving me what I want, I feel happy. Right? So you could have everything in life, but it rains, and you go like, no. I don't want rain today, and you feel unhappy. Right? You could have everything in life, but not rain, and you're a farmer, for example, you want to plant, you know, water your plants, and you go like, no, that's not right. I need rain. Rain in itself doesn't make you happy or unhappy, right? Rain in comparison with what you want from life is what makes you happy or unhappy. And you can put that in a very simple mathematical equation. Happiness is equal to or greater than the difference between the events of your life and your expectation of how life should behave, right? So that was truly eye-opening. Life in itself has no power over me to make me happy or unhappy. It's a comparison between what's happening in my life right now and how I want life to be that makes me happy or unhappy. With that, you would actually get a very accurate definition of what happiness is. Happiness is that contentment, that peaceful feeling you have when you're okay with life as it is. Right? So basically, if you're with a partner who is a human and who has some good things and some bad things, and you look at it as a holistic view and say, I'm okay with this. I like this guy. right? If you get to that point where you say, I'm okay with this, you'll find happiness. The problem is, the times when we find that the event does not meet our expectations, believe it or not, shows us what unhappiness truly is. And unhappiness simply, in that definition, is a survival mechanism. Believe it or not, the only or the main reason you have a brain is to solve this equation. Can you believe that? Everything we're given, we push to the extreme. Huh? We use our brains to invent iPhones, but the main fundamental reasons we had a brain, the fundamental reason is this, right? Your brain is constantly tasked with your survival. It wants to make sure that you're safe, you're comfortable, that you're in an environment that is good for you. And so what does it do? It constantly compares events to expectations. Sometimes up to 60,000 times a day. Can you believe that? You sat in this room, and you sit down, and your brain goes like, is this chair too hard? Is it too soft? Is it going to hurt my back? Right? A person that sits next to you, your brain goes like, are they a terrorist? Are they going to, you know, stab me in the back? Right? Truly, your brain is constantly doing this. Your partner says something, your brain goes like, does he love me? Does he not love me? Is he cheating on me? And so on and so forth. Right? We're constantly going through that. And every time your brain finds that the event doesn't match its expectations of a safe, comfortable model for your survival, it alerts you. But it doesn't alert you in the form of thought, because how many of us listen to the thoughts happening in our head? So it needs to alert you in something that is a little stronger. And what it does is it gives you an emotion. That emotion could be sadness, it could be fear, it could be anxiety, it could be regret, it could be shame, any of those negative emotions that we compile under the word unhappiness. Okay, so far? Everyone happy? Am I meeting your expectations? There you go. Okay. So with that understanding, I sat in front of that equation, I almost teared up. Because to an engineer, this is magic. You give it to me in an equation and that's it, I've solved it. The rest is hard work, right? And then suddenly I was like, no, but something's wrong with the mathematics. Because at age 23, life was not easy and I was happy. The events were difficult and I was happy. At age 29, my life was blessed with everything and I was unhappy. Something's wrong with the math, right? So I want you to do a quick exercise with me to correct this mathematics. The quick exercise is two tasks at the same time. I call it the blank brain test. It's two tasks at the same time. Task number one is I will ask you to do something very easy. I will ask you to think of something that makes you unhappy. Everyone here capable of doing that? Yeah, easy, right? You go to your brain, you say, hey brain, bring something that makes me unhappy. Your brain goes like, seriously? I have 276 things I want to talk to you about, right? Which one do you want? So we're going to start with that. I'm going to ask you to close your eyes and find that. But then at the same time, I'm going to ask you to do another task, which is a little more difficult. It will be a little bit of arithmetic to add a few numbers as they show up on the screen. The numbers will show up quickly, so it is not an easy task, but most Google engineers solve it. So let's see if you can solve it too. Okay. So task number one, please close your eyes, take 20 seconds, think of something that makes you unhappy. Get that unhappy feeling inside you and really let it sink in. Good. Now keep that unhappiness, please, and continue to be unhappy as you add those numbers as they appear on the screen. Easy. Oh, that's tough. Seriously? Okay, no, hold on. That's unfair. So I'm going to show you the numbers again. Please stay unhappy. Remember, the task was to stay unhappy. Now add those numbers. Good. Or don't add them. It doesn't really matter. Right. So here's what I tried to do. This is not a math test. This was a trick question. What I was trying to do is what we engineers call a full cycle simulation. Right? If I'm reverse engineering a machine, I wouldn't understand how the machine works until I get it from one extreme of its operation all the way to the other extreme and back. Right? So this is what I did to you. I asked you, am I meeting your expectations? Are you happy? Everyone laughed. Remember that? I was getting your signature that your T0 state was happy. Right? And then I asked you to close your eyes and think of something that makes you unhappy. T1 was unhappy. And then I showed you a few numbers on the screen. What happened? You were happy again. Interesting. That's your whole range of capabilities. You can move from happy to unhappy and back. Right? I didn't mean that, but anyway. So two questions that will completely change your life. Question number one is, between T0 and T1, has any event actually taken place in the real world? Interesting, huh? So I asked you to think of something that makes you unhappy. Boom, unhappiness on demand. You started to play the scenario from last weekend where your boyfriend said something annoying. Right? You can play it over and over and make yourself unhappy. But did he say it right now? No, he said it last weekend. It was as valid at T0 when you were happy as it is at T1 when you were unhappy. What's the only thing that changed between T0 and T1, may I ask? You started thinking. Interesting. So that unhappiness was not triggered by the real world. It was triggered by your thought. Question number two is even more important than question number one. I always tell people I will ask you to think of something that makes you unhappy for 20 seconds. I normally cannot take it. My heart hurts that I'm making you unhappy. So I normally keep it for around 8 seconds, right? Let me ask you a question. If I had asked you to stay unhappy, to stay with that thought for 8 minutes, not 8 seconds. No, 8 hours. Would your boyfriend have shown up and said, I'm sorry? Right? Would you be able to go back to last Friday and erase what happened? Would anything actually change in the real world at all? Nothing at all. So in engineering, this is the most stupid process we have ever invented. It is triggered by nothing. It can last for hours or days or years. It causes us to feel tortured, and it leads to nothing. Think about that. If you had a friend, do we have any Beckys in the room? No Beckys? Good. Yeah. Think about that. If you had a friend, we have one Becky? I apologize. Okay, so Jacqueline's, do we have any Jacqueline's in the room? Right. If you had a friend, her name is Jacqueline, and Jacqueline had that hobby of calling you every 7 minutes, tells you, okay, let's go somewhere on a corner. I'm going to tell you horrible things about yourself. I'm going to make you feel really bad, and I'm going to poke you in the ribs at the same time, and then I'm just going to let you go, and nothing is going to happen. Right? Would you really look forward to meeting Jacqueline? Would you listen to Jacqueline when she says, let's go? Right? Would you jump up and down in joy? Why would you do that? Your brain, Jacqueline, really wakes up every 7 minutes and says, I have something to annoy you with. Right? And you go like, yeah, let's do it. Right? It's really weird. It's such a waste of time. Now let's get serious, because happiness, honestly, is a serious matter. Okay? This is a total waste of your life. If I were to show you a way to stop your brain from doing that, would you please commit to take charge and stop doing it? Good. Okay. So how do you do that? Understand then, that the way we think is what makes us unhappy. Huh? Does anyone here have a voice in their head telling them what to do? Anyone? Yeah? Anyone? I'm going to give you another chance. Those who have not raised their hands are lying, okay? Anyone has more than one voice? Lady? Yeah? Okay, well, there you go. I have an orchestra up there, right? Right. Please don't be shocked, but that voice looks exactly like this.
Worst is my friend. You don't have any friends. Nobody likes you. Not listening. You're a liar and a thief.
No. Murderer.
Go away. Go away! I hate you.
Seriously. This is exactly what it looks like, huh? We have that voice in there telling us weird things, painful things. Now, if you don't like this guy, let me introduce you to your suffering machine. Right? So I would dare say that there has never been a moment in your entire life, that you felt unhappy that was not produced by this 3-pound lump of meat. Right? Because I told you, the events have no power over you until you put them through this machine and give them the power to torture you. Right? One of you might look at me right now and in your mind say, he's an idiot. Right? If I'm not aware of this, I'm not upset. If you say it and I go like, okay, and I don't think about it, I'm not upset. I'm only upset if I start to turn it into my head. Right? Now, if this machine is the reason for our suffering, then fixing this machine is on the path to stop our suffering. Now, how do you fix this machine? Understand it. This machine truly, truly is the most powerful tool you've ever been given. But there are two things about it that you don't understand well, right? Seriously, this moment is going to change your life forever. So what time is it now? I don't know. 4. Yeah, 4 o'clock today. Remember this moment forever because your life is going to change from now on, right? Who here tends to believe that this machine is you talking to you? I think, therefore I am. Of course, right? In the modern world that we live in, we've glorified thought so much that we started to think that the thoughts in our heads are me telling me what to do. Right? I have a few questions to ask you. How many of you wake up in the morning and tell yourself, I am the blood pumping in my veins? Does anyone do that? Anyone has that conviction or habit? Your heart, as a biological function, produces blood. That's the biological product of your heart. It doesn't produce it. It pumps it around your body. Right? The biological function of your heart is to pump blood around your body. Nobody wakes up and says, I'm blood. Anyone here thinks you're urine? No? No? The other one? No? Sometimes, maybe. No? But seriously. Huh? The biological function of your kidneys is to get the toxins out of your body in the form of urine. No one says, I'm urine. For some reason, however, though the biological function of your brain is thoughts, you start to say, oh, but I'm thoughts. It's me talking to me. Now, can I ask you a question? If it was you talking to you, why would you need to talk? Do you understand that? There was a study by MIT in 2007 that put people in MRI machines, right, and gave them word puzzles. So word puzzles are solved somewhere around here. It took a few seconds for the participants to actually solve the problem. And then, interestingly, the verbal communication engine of the brain, the part that we use when we speak out loud, the part that must be lighting up now as I'm talking to you, starts to light up in the participant's head for up to 8 seconds before the participant actually knows the answer. So the brain would solve the problem and literally turn it into English so that you understand it. Your brain is literally talking to you. Right? But it's not you. It's just a biological organ. It's Jacqueline. You understand that? It's a third party. Right? When you realize that, your entire relationship with that machine changes. Because you suddenly have the power to say, you know what, Jacqueline? I don't have to obey. Right? You know what, Jacqueline? I don't think you're right. You know what, Jacqueline? I think you should go back and do some more homework before you talk to me. Right? And I absolutely deal with my brain that way. I'm going to tell you a little bit about that, but let me tell you something else. Before we go from here, it's I am, therefore I think. As a matter of fact, it's I am, therefore my brain thinks. This is the truth. Right? Now, if that is the case, let me learn how to use that machine. If I gave you a Bugatti Veyron, one of the fastest cars on earth, and you drove it around Miami like a maniac, you're going to kill yourself and everybody. Right? This is the best tool you've ever been given, but we don't really know how to use it. And most of us think that we have one type of thoughts running through our heads. We have 3 types of thoughts. Right? One of them is insightful thinking. You know what insightful thinking is? It's your analytical abilities to introspect, to look at the world outside you and understand and analyze and make decisions. This is what makes us able to invent iPhones. Right? Insightful thinking is the MIT study I was telling you about. It happens on the right side hand of the brain. Right? Even more useful, which is barely used in the modern world, is experiential thinking. Experiential thinking, Anahita was talking about that yesterday. It happens in your insula and your prefrontal cortex of the brain. Right? Experiential thinking is if I tell you, can you find the color yellow on this slide? What do? You zoom in, you find the color yellow. You don't think about it, you don't judge it, you don't say, I like yellow, I hate yellow, this part of the brain is not supposed to be yellow. Right? You just find yellow. You experience the world as it really is. Now, that's what we do when we meditate. Right? When I say focus on your breathing, what you really are doing is you are focusing on something that's actually happening in the real world, which is your breathing. Right? When that happens, it happens here. Right? They did a study with in the University of Toronto in 2007, very eye-opening. They got two groups of participants. They trained one group to meditate for eight weeks. They put them in the MRI machines. They didn't launch into the kinds of thoughts that make us unhappy. They basically focused on their breathing. And as they focused on their breathing, this side of the brain lit up. The rest of the participants who were not trained, you know what they did? They got into the MRI machine, they started to think about, my boss is annoying, my boyfriend is horrible, I'm never going to be able to find a good man, I hate dating, I'm going to spend the rest of my life alone. Right? And when they start to do that, the midline areas of their brains lit up. Right? The process I was telling you about. Triggered by nothing, they're in an MRI machine, and leading to nothing, no one showed up to apologize in the MRI machine. Right? And so that incessant thinking is where all of the sadness and unhappiness happens. Now, I told you I deal with my brain as a third party. Right? What that means is I have a deal with my brain that allows my brain to bring up only two kinds of thought. One of them is joyful thought, and the other is useful thought. It's a very simple deal. When Jacqueline shows up, I look at what she says, and I say, is this useful or is it joyful? If it's not, she goes back and thinks about something else. Right? It's really not that difficult. Huh? Let me give you a couple of examples. You know, my son left my world. When my son left my world, as a father, I felt very guilty. So I immediately, my brain started to go, you should have driven him to another hospital, you should have driven him to another hospital. Right? And I started to go like, oh yeah, I should have driven him to another hospital. It actually is a valid thought. It's not like a wrong thought. And then I said, but is this useful, brain? Can I do anything with this right now? Can I go back and drive him to another hospital? Is that actually within my capabilities in any way? Can you go back and think about something I could do? Right? And of course, my brain resisted. It took me 4 days, but then 4 days later, my brain wakes up and says, hey, I have an idea. Why don't we write his happiness model, share it with the world, and make 10 million people happy? Great. Thanks, brain. That's useful. Right? It doesn't bring him back. Understand that. It doesn't bring him back, but it's a useful thought. And the minute you move the thought from here to here, useful means you sit down, you write, you engage, you analyze, you experience, you research. You're in a place that is not the place of suffering that we live in up here. Right? Joyful thoughts are even more interesting because, by the way, we don't have to be serious about everything in life all the time. Joyful thoughts are, until today, I'll tell you openly so that you don't misunderstand me. I feel the pain of losing Ali every day. The pain will always be there. Right? I wake up every day and my brain starts the day with, Ali died. And I go like, yeah, Ali lived. If we're going to be two parties having a conversation, we have the right to have different points of view. My brain says Ali died because it's trained to look for what's wrong in life. I say Ali lived because it was the best thing I was ever given. Do you understand this? I had this wonderful soul in my house as a guest for 21 and a half years. We played together, we laughed together. It was wonderful. Would I ever give up on this for anything in the world? Absolutely not. Right? And Ali lives gives me 21 and a half years of total, beautiful, incredible memories to think about. And when I say Ali lived, my brain starts to bring thoughts from that place. Right? Think about that, because we're in control. We can take charge if we start to make that separation. Just to allow time for questions, it's not really that simple. Because some of you who are spiritual will know that you're not your brain, you're not your thoughts. This is that very first bullet up there, of the six grand illusions. So Solve for Happy as a research as a book actually covers a much wider spectrum of what makes us unhappy. The six and the seven are the reasons for unhappiness. The five is the answer to happiness. Right? Let me go through those quickly. The six are six grand illusions. These are things that we've learned to believe in the modern world to become successful. They make us successful, but they're not true, and so in the process, they make us unhappy. Right? Thought is one of them. Huh? Thought is real. Thought is not an illusion, but the illusion is, I think, therefore I am. Did you notice that I actually didn't give you any exercises to fix this issue? The minute you know the illusion, it doesn't affect you anymore. The minute you see the illusion that I think, I am, therefore I think, or I am, therefore my brain thinks is the reality, yeah, Jacqueline is going to bring up a few thoughts every now and then, but I can guarantee you for the rest of your life, when she starts to talk too much, you're going to go like, hey, brain, seriously, can you bring me a useful thought or a joyful thought? Simple as that, right? And once you know the illusion, it doesn't affect you anymore. There are six grand illusions. There are seven blind spots. The seven blind spots are actually not mistakes. They're not errors in your brain. They're the way your brain is designed. Understand, this machine is from the ancient years of caveman or cavewoman years, right? In those times when the tiger showed up, your brain had absolutely no interest in telling you, wow, what a beautiful animal, right? Because honestly, I mean, a tiger is beautiful if you really think about it. Your brain is designed to say we're going to die. And so 60 to 70% of the thoughts in an adult brain are negative. Is it possible even that 60 to 70% of your day is negative? It's not at all, right? The reason is because of seven blind spots. Your brain is biased by design to look for what's wrong. And when it looks for what's wrong, events are missing expectations all the time in your happiness equation, and the result is unhappiness, right? If you fix the six grand illusions and the seven blind spots, and by the way, no one has to fix all six and all seven. Everyone that's ever read the book or attended my training will say it was one grand illusion and one blind spot that really, really pushed 80, 90% of my unhappiness. For me specifically, it was the illusion of control and it was the blind spot of labeling. Right? Once you get rid of those, 85% of the unhappiness goes away, and then it starts to go from there. I can give you examples from fitness about that when we have a chat, but truly, it's all about that being that hyper-targeted in your approach. You find what is not working for you, you fix it, and the rest is easy. The five ultimate truths truly is the Jedi Master level of finding happiness. So you fix those, your black belt, you want to go to Jedi Master, you hang on to the truth, right? Interestingly, you understand that the two opposite poles of a magnet attract. Do you understand that about physics? If you put north and south poles of a magnet, they will attract. Has that ever upset you? If you had your finger between them and it squeezed your finger, did you blame life for it? Did you complain about it for 2 weeks to your friends? Never. Right? Why? Because you expect it. You understand the truth of physics is that they will attract. And so when they attract, it doesn't bother you at all. This is the approach to go through life, to hang on to the truth, to understand that the truth is the way to navigate life. And when you do, it doesn't upset you. Sometimes you're not going to like it. Death is one of the truths. Right? We don't like that, but it's the truth. When Ali died, I called my brother and I said, Khaled, is that even possible? And he said, I'm so sorry, Habibi, but humans perform surgeries and we make mistakes. They're 1 in 10 million, but there are hundreds of millions of surgeries happening every year. And so they happen. Tens of thousands of people die, right? I mean, in my brain, I was like, no child should ever leave the world before his father. But no, when Ali left, I got so many people coming to me saying, I lost a loved one too. I lost a child too. Right? It doesn't make it any better, but it makes it part of the way the game is played. Right? It makes it part of two opposite magnets two opposite poles of a magnet attract. And when you realize that, you start to master the game. You don't object to what is the reality of how life is. You play with what the reality of life is. You beat life, even though there is no competition and winning, but you stand on your feet, because you understand how it is. And when you understand how it is, you're at the best that you can be. So 6, 7, 5, Remember your promise? Yeah. So Anahita always presents that. Huh? All the suffering in the world is from wishing happiness for oneself, and all the happiness in the world is from wishing happiness to others. So I beg you to tell people, it's not about books. Teach everyone around you that they deserve to be happy, that they can be happy if they invest an hour a day in their happiness, and that they should tell others to be happy. We can absolutely change our world if we do that. And be kind enough to send a happy wish to Ali. He was absolutely the best person I ever met. Okay, we have 15 minutes for questions, so I was hoping for 20, but maybe we can run over time a little, so questions? Yes, sir.
You said you were going to address how you're measuring the 10
million. Yes. So how am I measuring the 10 million happy? I'm measuring the 10 million happy on three parameters: that people have received a message that made them prioritize their happiness somehow. That's very easy to measure on social media, how many people get that message, see the video all the way through, and sometimes liking it or sharing it means that they went through the second and the third step of the mission. So the mission is you decide to prioritize your own happiness. You realize that the lies that the modern world told us that we should go through our life unhappy because it's the tax we pay for our success is not true, and you actually decide to prioritize your happiness. Number two is you actually find the resources and spend time to invest in your own happiness. Remember this, huh? I can tell you, if you eat healthy and you go to the gym 4 to 5 times a week, you're going to be fit, right? But without going to the gym 4 to 5 times a week, it's not going to happen. Regardless of how much you want it, it's not going to happen. Similarly with happiness, how many of us would wake up every day and prioritize an hour a day for our happiness? So invest in your happiness is number two. And find the compassion in your heart to make others happy. This is not, the life we live is not acceptable. One in every four people is clinically depressed. That basically means at least half of us are unhappy. Much more, many more. All right, so we have a microphone there.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much.
I think
that by you bringing Ali into our awareness, he lives on in all the people that you're touching. So thank you very much. A question in regards to the formula you shared with us, dealing with basic human rights and when those are being violated, and going back to where we started with the pictures of the babies, that some people that we do come in touch with as we're helping you build this movement and helping build our own movements, how do you suggest we sort of bring this to that level? Because when, you know, there's a lot of people that don't have the basic three human rights: shelter, food, and love.
Yes. So. A great question, by the way. So reality of all that we're talking about is for you guys in the room, right? Who are not human trafficked, who are not suffering from, you know, a hunger or, you know, all of the calamities that we have in life, right? When we talk about those who are so unfortunate, so disadvantaged in life, I think the first thing we should do is to acknowledge and actually wish and feel it in our heart for them to be better, but also for us to be grateful for what we feel, what we enjoy every day. One of my chapters has a concept that I call look down. When you start to look down at how many people in the world today are less fortunate than you are, you truly start to appreciate how fortunate you are. I mean, just think of one day in your life where you have a very bad headache, and just be grateful for all of the other days that you don't have it, right? That's one side. The other side truly is, of course, it's our role to help. It's our role to engage. It's our role to change people's lives. And somehow, I will tell you hands down, we are motivated in the modern world by fear. And the fear stops us from giving. It's like, you know what? I'm just going to give a dollar and, you know, try to help a little bit. But I need the other $9,999 to just make sure that I never miss a coffee because, you know, it's important for me to have my coffee in the morning. I can tell you very openly that the economics of love and giving will tell me that if you give the 9,000 and keep the 1,000, you will get 90,000 back. I know that to be true, right? Now, so what I'm asking you to do is to actually get out of your comfort zone. Never again give something to someone that doesn't make a difference. next time you give, give to make a difference, right? If you tip a waitress, tip her the coffee that you bought. Buy her a coffee. She gives you a coffee, buy her a coffee, right? If you find someone who's homeless and you really want to help them, find it in your heart to give them $50. And don't give again for a week or two or five or whatever it is. But just make a difference, because honestly, our life, our world needs it. Having said that, I will have to say part of the tests of life is that some of us are disadvantaged, right? Some of us are still living in Syria and suffering from what's happening in Syria. Some of us are, you know, homeless, and maybe I cannot help every homeless person in the world. The first thing you do is you give them your heart. Don't pass by a homeless person again, I beg you, and go like, yeah, it's okay. It's not okay. If you cannot help, if you cannot take them off the street, at least feel it in your heart. At least understand that it's not okay. At least have the empathy to say, oh my God, I'm so lucky, right? And with that, I think we're going to start to change the world. I think Anahita yesterday spoke about the hyper-normalization of reality. This truly is the biggest issue with our world today, is that we're starting to accept what's wrong. And I don't think we should anymore. Yes. Questions? Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I'm saying thank you, by the way, because the previous presentation said accept the compliment. I normally get very shy, so yeah, yes.
I'd love to accept the idea to train 1 hour a day.
Yeah.
But I have a personal trainer, so, and he tells me what to do.
Yeah.
Is there somewhere I can go?
Yes, there is a ton of material on happiness. So the question is, if I train 1 hour a day, what should I do? Because, you know, maybe I should look for a personal trainer. There are personal trainers on happiness. There are coaches. There is a ton of material out there on YouTube. I personally have all of my you know, courses. I have them. I taught a course in Stanford, and I have it online for free. I will have to tell you that happiness is hyper-personal. We all are the same in terms of events and expectations. We all are the same in terms of the illusions that affect us. But to dive in deep is a very personal experience. I would ask you to find the happiest of your friends and spend more time with them, right? And just observe and learn. I would ask you to simply form a group of your friends and say, let's get together every week and talk about one happy topic, right? Just research, make it your everyday life that this is your biggest objective. And I promise you, if you invest in it, you may not be the happiest person on earth in a month or two, but you're absolutely going to be happier literally tomorrow, and even happier a week later, and even happier a month later. Yes. Yes.
Before she said, and I wanted to say something. I'm a speaker. I'm all starting in this way of happiness in my country, in Colombia. And I have
I love Colombia. Welcome.
And I have a phrase that I use, and I think happiness is the path that you build every day with your decisions. And when you can accept that, you're on the other way.
Absolutely, happiness is the path for sure. Happiness is, in my view. I say that happiness is your default setting. By that, I mean it is the only way you can be at your optimum performance along your path through life, right? And most of us forget because we're taught to wait for something. If I get this, or if I have that, or if I'm with that person, I'll be happy. As a matter of fact, it's almost the exact opposite. If you're happy, you're going to be with that person. If you're happy, you're going to get this. If you're happy, you're going to get that. Right? And I think that the idea of us waiting for happiness shouldn't be the case at all. It is truly every part of the way. Yes. Shout. Yes.
Actually, I wanted to talk to her because me, myself, I've struggled personally about practicing happiness. Many years ago, over 25 years ago, I started practicing as an attorney, and I started as a criminal attorney. But it was so unhappy, I left it. So I went to the corporate world. I was still very unhappy. And finally, last year, I was looking at my four children, and I say, if I let them live their lives as accomplished as I have and feel so unhappy, I fail as a mom. So what I did is that I changed my life. I left my career. I'm dedicating my life to happy. But most importantly, on International Happiness Day, I'm starting at 365 days of happy, where online I'm going to walk 360 days putting out there what happiness looks like. I don't know. I haven't spent one entire year of my life being happy, but I'm willing to do it and to share it with the tribe. And my idea is exactly that. Make it easy, being like a happy trainer, and help people to join me in this tribe and practice happiness in the very simple, practical ways that will shift our brain. And in 365 days, we can be a different person. So
I totally agree. Yeah.
Question right here.
I totally agree. So, but can I add to this, huh? There is one decision that you can make every day from now until the end of the 365 days that will make you happier, which is, what can I do today to be happier? Right? It really is that simple. What can I do today to be happier? I don't know if you know this. I may have said it in other talks. I wake up once a quarter, and I look at every friend that I met in the last 3 months. Everyone I interacted with, on everything on my calendar or WhatsApp and so on. If I find that they didn't make me happy, I simply send them a text and say, I don't want to be your friend anymore. Right? It's those kinds of decisions that I am hyper jealous and protective of my happiness. If someone is not going to make me happy, they shouldn't be in my life. As a matter of fact, you look for the people that constantly make you happier, right? And you know, those kinds of decisions of like, okay, yesterday I removed this from my life, it made me happier. What can I do today that will make me happier by the end of the day?
So quick question. So, I love that you're doing so much with positive computing. It's amazing. And with what you're doing, it's very much in line with what I feel like is like Marty Seligman's kind of PERMA 51 goal. You know, kind of making 51% of the world's population flourishing by 2051, mm-hmm. which is, you know, yeah. 1 billion. It's great. So from a positive computing standpoint, what else other than like what you've been you talked about this yesterday in the AI, what can engineers and people who are in that world, what can they do? What can we do to help them to be more aware of this?
Yeah, I decided to be out of that spectrum. If you notice my decision, I think we need to bias the data a little bit at the beginning. I think we need to be very protective of what we're teaching our 18-month-old infants, and I think it's important that we understand for the first time that the impact of the technology that we're developing cannot actually be ignored anymore. You know, if you develop mobile technology and the mobile technology, you know, sort of stresses a few people, that's fine. But what we're about to build here needs a ton of responsibility. So you know how Spider-Man will says, with great power comes great responsibility? I think it's about time that we as developers keep that in mind. And whatever is within our power to create something that is going to be net positive for the world is something we should do. Yes. So I don't know what we're doing on time. Are you guys going to kick me off stage when it's time? I think that's fair. Yeah? Yeah, 5 more minutes. Yeah. Yeah.
So my son is a high school senior in Broward County. He's very involved as a student leader in the Never Again movement with the post-Marjorie Stoneham Douglas shooting. Those kids, their activism is really stems from their suffering, right? The suffering and the collective. So what would you tell them as they're using their suffering towards, you know, useful, towards action, what would you tell them about adding happiness to the work that they're doing?
I have never respected an initiative that I have seen. I say that with respect to America, but I have never seen, I've ever respected an initiative like what the kids are doing. They're incredible and they're absolutely amazing, and it's an initiative that's way too late. Now, And I absolutely have to tell you, we should all be ashamed that our children are leading this. Can you imagine that? We've loaded them so much that they said, enough is enough. That's it, right? You guys don't know what you're doing. It's about time we change this. The one thing I realized as I grew older is that I learned through my life to be motivated by the negative, right? And being motivated by the negative seems to be part of our success-driven, you know, society. It's like I'm never going to do this again because I don't want my parents to be unhappy, or I'm going to score an A in mathematics because I don't want my teacher to think I'm stupid or whatever that is. We can do the exact same things by being motivated by the positive, right? Being motivated by the positive is truly to look at the world we are in today, and instead of feeling negative, to be inspired by the world we can create. Right? And, you know, I really think that the idea of all of us standing together and painting a positive picture of the world going forward, instead of trying to deny the negatives of the world we live in, would probably be a minor shift that would make things a lot better. Like I spoke yesterday, instead of saying, me too, we should have said never again. Right? And I think the idea here is asking them too much. So between you and I, for the first time ever, I said, be motivated by the negative, but make the change. Now, our kids are doing this because we, again, accepted a world that we should not accept, right? I honestly and truly believe that we have a role to play. We should say, when is this going to end? I mean, how uninformed, unaware can we be to allow this to happen over and over and over and over, right? And I'm not American, so I don't have the right to take a stand, but I'm a human. I cannot accept to see another time where someone is killed because we didn't take a stand. So if you ask me, I think we should all leave this conference and go join them. Honestly. I mean, we should follow them. We should follow them where they shout and say enough is enough. Yes.
Hello. Thank you for your wisdom. I am a coach with Tony Robbins, and I deal with the topic of happiness all the time. And depression is the number one cause of disability globally.
Yeah.
So people are obsessed with the concept of happiness. And I want to take the opportunity to ask you, what's your opinion on the role of emotions?
Oh, that's a great question.
Thank you.
Okay, so I the role of emotions, huh? So I tend to come across as a heartless engineer sometimes, right? I'm not at all. But I'll tell you this, huh? As a matter of fact, I actually am the biggest advocate of not only acknowledging your emotions, but embracing your emotions. You know, when people talk to me about meditation and how we should sense our toe and our, third eye or whatever that is, I basically have one of my very interesting meditation practices, even though I don't call it meditation at all, is to sit down on aeroplanes and be aware and become aware of my thoughts and my emotions. Right? This is to me, again, black belt of awareness. It's not just my neck is hurting, but my head is saying something and I'm not listening. As a matter of fact, when you start to say that, to do that, your brain goes like, did you hear me? Oh, that's great. I don't need to say this again. Right? And honestly, emotions are the one that we are so trained in the modern world, especially the Western modern world, to completely push down and ignore. Next time you wake up in the morning and your partner or your mother or whatever tells you, are you okay? Don't say, no, I'm fine. Please don't. And next time someone asks you, how are you doing? Don't answer the typical American answer of, I'm just fine, right? I actually ask my friends, huh? I stop and I think when they tell me, how are you doing? I go like, I'm actually quite energetic today with a lot of worries on my mind about the schedule for tomorrow, and I have a pain in my shoulder, right? That's my answer, right? Because it truly is an opportunity to reflect. Now, I will say this, however. Emotions, in my view, believe it or not, maybe because I'm a hyper engineer, are triggered by thoughts. They're not triggered by events, and they're not triggered by chemicals. Our emotions trigger chemicals, okay? And they are triggered by our thought. And if you reframe the thought, you reframe the emotion. You understand that? So if you get into an Uber and the Uber driver doesn't smile, the event is the Uber driver did not smile. The thought is he disrespected me. That thought is not the event. That thought is my brain's way of looking at the event. Right? If I actually tell myself, how can he disrespect me? He doesn't even know me. Right? The thought suddenly changes and the emotion goes away. I don't feel insulted. I don't feel disrespected. I don't feel unhappy anymore. So number one is when you meditate next time, meditate on your emotions. And if you're not meditating enough, Meditate so that you meditate on your emotions. Like literally give yourself 15 minutes twice a day to sit down and say, what am I actually feeling? Am I stressed? Am I angry? Am I anxious? And acknowledge it and embrace it completely. Don't blame yourself for it. It's like, I am angry. It's good. I'm angry. It is what it is. I'm angry, right? And then trace it to where it came from. I'm angry because. If you can reframe it, it will go away. If you don't reframe it, at least you're aware, right? And so with that, I think, I came to chapter 12, which was about love, and I think is the only emotion that's not triggered by a thought, right? And ask yourself, the Jedi master of awareness is what's missing, not what's happening. So you can actually become aware of the thoughts in your head, you can become aware of the feelings and emotions in your heart. The Jedi master level is to become aware of what emotions are you not having, right? Because this truly is what matters. And if you find that you haven't felt love for half an hour, you're in very bad shape, right? So if you can actually start to tell yourself what, I mean, look for a butterfly or something to love it. And when you put that emotion in there all the time, all other emotions go away. It's really interesting. Shall I go? I go. Great, thank you.
Thank you, Mo.